And I welcome you for this day three pediatric acute care training, which is part of the COVID Pulse, which is a pediatric intensive care CMC Vellore initiative. Today, I'm really happy to introduce two moderators, where none other than our own pediatric intensive care fellow, who did their fellowship here, and now they are the consultants at different places. And Dr. Ankit Om Prakash Gupta. Ankit, welcome you, and I'm really happy to see you. You're busy, probably you're seen in Scrub. He's the consultant and lead pediatric intensivist of pediatric ICU, Okar Hospital, Mira Road, Mumbai. He did, after his MD pediatrics, he did the Indian Diploma on Pediatric Critical Care Medicine of the IAP College of Pediatric Critical Care at CMC Vellore, as well as the postdoctoral fellowship in pediatric intensive care at CMC Vellore. He worked in Narayana Health SRCC Children's Hospital in Mumbai as consultant, and now he's working in Wockhardt Hospital and the lead pediatric intensivist. His area of interest are 2D echo and lung ultrasound. Welcome, Ankit, to moderate this session. And next we have another moderator, Dr. Antar Patel, who is a consultant and lead pediatric intensivist, pediatric ICU at Ananthapuri Hospitals and Research Institute at Thiruvananthapuram. After his DNB pediatrics, he did the Indian Diploma of Pediatric Critical Care Medicine of the IAP College Pediatric Critical Care at CMC Vellore, along with the postdoctoral fellowship in pediatric intensive care. He worked as consultant in Columbia Asia and Cloud 9 Hospitals in Bengaluru before going into Ananthapuri Hospitals in Thiruvananthapuram. Welcome you, Antar. So over to you, both Antar and Ankit, to introduce the speaker and the topic of today. Over to you. You can see Sankit's profile here.
Thank you so much, Igor, sir. Whatever I say about sir will be less. And despite being so busy, sir, make sure that we learn even when we are so far away. Sir, make sure that we both, everybody who has graduated from there, we learn, we keep learning, and learning is a continuous process. I'll not take much time. And it's good to see everybody. I saw the participants. It's good to see everybody. I still remember our days when we used to sit and sir used to make us do chalk talk and our regular mortality meets. So again, this I have become quite nostalgic. Without wasting more time, I'd like to introduce Dr. Sanket. So Dr. Sanket is our assistant professor and consultant pediatric intensivist at CMC Vellore. He has done his MD Pediatric from PIMS and his IDPPCM from CMC Vellore and his postdoctoral fellowship from CMC Vellore. Today, Dr. Sanket will be talking about oxygen therapy and delivery devices that we regularly use. This is very much helpful in our recent COVID times, in our pandemic, and also very helpful for our general pediatricians. Okay, how do they use the nasal high flow cannulas, NRMs and other things? That is what Dr. Sanket would be emphasizing on. Over to you, Dr. Sanket. Dr. Antar wants to say something.
Nice to see you, Antar. Welcome. You can moderate, and over to Sanket.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Sanket. Today, I'll be talking on oxygen therapy and its conservation strategies. An overview of what I'm going to tell today. Initially, we'll talk about the indications of oxygen therapy, and what are the other strategies to improve oxygen delivery to the tissue other than delivery devices, and detailed information on the available oxygen delivery devices, and a few slides on heated humidified high flow nasal cannula, its indications, and how to set up the equipment. We'll have a video session also on it, and some basic tips on how to conserve oxygen in an acute care setting. So oxygen, it is the most commonly used therapeutic agent in a critically ill child in hospital, and it is the most inappropriately used drug also in most of the clinical situations. We use it very frequently without any indications also. Okay, so what does it have? What does happen when we give too much of oxygen? So there's no any cutoff, a single value that oxygen toxicity can occur. Usually they say less than 60% is considered safe. So what are the complications that can occur? In a chronic patient who has been adapted to a hypoxia, when you give oxygen, that also can cause depression in the ventilation. In case of newborns, it can cause retinopathy of prematurity, and retroventral fibroplasia can occur. And when you give more oxygen when it is not required, it can cause, it can wash out your nitrogen and it can cause absorption atelectasis. And there's a risk of fire hazard also. And with this delivery devices, we use your mask NIV or mask or nasal prongs or NIV, whichever you use, it can damage the nose and the nasal septums. And when you use long-term oxygen therapy, that can cause fibrotic changes in the lungs. So it is better to use the lowest possible FiO2 or lowest possible oxygen, whichever is required, depending on your tissue oxygenation and your whether your oxygen device has to be de-escalated or escalated. Depending on the patient oxygenation, you have to frequently monitor it. So your delivering oxygen not only depends only on your saturation or your SpO2 or your PaO2 on the gas. It also, your oxygen delivery to the tissues also depends on your other three things. The main three things are your hemoglobin concentration, your cardiac output also. So if you see the formula, your delivery of oxygen, this is the DO2. It depends upon the cardiac output and the oxygen that is bound to the hemoglobin and the dissolved oxygen in the blood. So your most of the 90% of your oxygen will be carried by your hemoglobin and only 1% will be carried by your dissolved oxygen. So what we give is, what we give oxygen goes, gets dissolved in your blood and then your delivery of oxygen increases. But the other two things also you should monitor. Your cardiac output also should improve. So you should maintain your blood pressures, normal blood pressures, or at least more than your 50th centile. And your hemoglobin also you should maintain at least 7 in case of shock we use. And in case of cardiac situations, we use 10 and 12 also. We use different cutoffs depending on your situations. So your cardiac output should be maintained, your hemoglobin should be maintained, and your other hemoglobins like deoxyhemoglobin also should be monitored. And one more thing during delivery of oxygen is the oxygen stores we use. Normally oxygen, as I said, is carried by your hemoglobin and dissolved in oxygen, and some oxygen is stored in your FRC in the lung. So once we give, so this is a tabular column in the study that showed normal breathing air, how much your FRC is, and once you provide 100% oxygen, it goes up to 3 to 4 times your oxygen stores increases. So that's why we, before surgery or before intubating, we give pre-oxygenation. That increases your reserve of oxygen. So coming to the common causes of hypoxia, the most two common broad classification of hypoxia causes are arterial hypoxemia and failure in your transport system that carries your oxygen. So your arterial hypoxemia can occur, like your inspired oxygen can come down. When you're in a high altitude, there may be low FiO2, or when the child is not breathing or apnea is there, or any opiate overdose that can cause low work of breathing that can cause hyperventilation, where your FiO2 decreases again. And when there's a ventilation perfusion mismatch in case of acute asthma or hyperinflated lung fields, that can all cause VQ mismatch, or your cardiac patients where your right to left shunt occurs. And the other broad classification is your transport system. Like I said, hemoglobin carries your oxygen. The 99% of your delivery of oxygen is by your hemoglobin, which is saturated with oxygen. So that can be disturbed in case of low hemoglobin concentration. Low hemoglobin can also cause, or your hemoglobinopathies like your carboxyhemoglobin or your thalassemia, can all these hemoglobinopathies can also cause decrease in your transport of oxygen. In case of cyanide poisoning or sepsis, where your transport of oxygen is reduced, and even your cardiac output reduces, that also can cause decrease in your delivery of oxygen. So how do we assess oxygenation? What are the common, this is just one slide on how to assess oxygenation, not only on your saturation or your PaO2 in the gas. The other things, how to monitor oxygenation is, we have these different formulas in case of when you're using oxygenation, high flows oxygen, when you're using NIV, we monitor PF ratios. And depending on the severity, we have mild, moderate, and severe AIDS. And the SF ratio, if you don't have an arterial blood test, we can use the saturation also. Just with the saturation and your delivery of the amount of oxygen you use, we can monitor SF ratio. And the other things like arterial oxygen gradient, there is a formula where that can differentiate between the causes of hypoxemia, whether it is due to hypoventilation or whether it is VQ mismatch. These formulas can differentiate between the causes of hypoxia. And in case of invasively ventilated patients, your oxygen index can be used, where the formula is mean airway pressure into FiO2 by PaO2. So the airway pressure that we use in invasive ventilation and the FiO2 we use by your PaO2 that we get in the air, what we give and what we get, so that you can monitor. and the other markers, like I said, cardiac output also is an important thing in your delivering of oxygen. So how do we monitor this cardiac output? We have this new surrogate markers like mixed venous saturation gas or lactate. All these studies have shown these are also can these all these lactate this measurement of this and serial monitoring also helps in monitoring your cardiac output and your tissue oxygenation. And this DO2 and VO2 we can have a trend of DO2 and VO2 ratios, oxygen extraction ratios. All this can help in assessing your tissue oxygenations. This SpO2 and PO2 are just broad numbers which can macro numbers which shows your oxygenation. And in case of micro numbers, we can use this lactate and SvO2 and DO2. So how to select oxygen device is depends on your degree of hypoxemia. If a child is in respiratory failure, we directly go with invasive oxygen delivery devices like intubation. We have to go, and with even patient comfort, if like child is in just in respiratory distress, we can use different oxygen delivery devices depending on the patient comfort and patient cost. Now, our patients being mostly pediatric patients, we have to see the patient comfort also. If a child is not comfortable with your nasal prongs, better to change with other mask, nasal mask or high flow devices you can use. And if you don't have an high flow nasal cannulas like this airborne optic flow, which are costly, then even we have to see. So in those cases, we can use an NRM. And when there's an oxygen scarcity is there, then we don't use this high flow nasal cannulas. We better use NRM devices which conserves oxygen. So your choice of oxygen delivery devices also depends on all these four issues. So from where do we get oxygen? How is oxygen delivered to our critical care settings? So the most three common things are hospitals uses liquid oxygen tank. These are called liquid oxygen cryogenic cylinders, which stores large amount of oxygen. And we have this compressed gas cylinders. So these are the gas cylinders with black and white shoulders in India, and different capacities are available, and which can hold, and the time which can last is shown in this tabular column. And the third is the oxygen concentrators, where in case of where you don't have an oxygen source, these oxygen concentrators can be used with the power supply, which does not store oxygen, but they produce oxygen from the atmospheric air by absorption of nitrogen onto some aluminium silicates in this monitor. And they can deliver up to maximum of 8 to 10 liters of flow they can deliver. And now these oxygen concentrators have a you can even humidify those oxygen that you deliver through these oxygen concentrators, depending upon the different manufacturers they deliver. So coming to our main topic, which is today, is on oxygen delivery devices. These oxygen delivery devices, they can be broadly classified into low flow oxygen delivery devices and high flow oxygen delivery devices. And one more classification is your fixed performance devices and variable performance devices, because some devices can give low flow oxygen also, some devices can act as an high flow oxygen device also. So examples for this low flow oxygen devices is one which delivers oxygen less than your child's inspiratory flow rate, or in crude term they say your oxygen when your FiO2 is delivered up to 60%, they say that is, so when your low flow oxygen delivered, when you your FiO2 is delivered up to 60%, they say it is low flow oxygen devices, and when it delivers more than 60%, they say high flow. But it is mainly on the inspiratory flow rate that they provide. So examples of low flow oxygen delivery systems are your nasal cannula, simple oxygen mask, or your Venturi devices, that is a variable performance which can deliver low flow also and high flow also. Your HHFNC, they are also variable performance devices where they deliver low flow also and high flow devices. Examples of your high flow systems are your NRM and your HFNC and your oxygen hood mask that we use in neonates. Those are all high flow nasal flow systems. So coming to the initially, I'll talk about low flow devices. The most nasal cannula are also called as nasal prongs. This is the most commonly used oxygen delivery device because it consumes less oxygen and it is easy to use. So, and it is available in different sizes depending on the patient's age, depending on the patient's nasal size, and depending upon the width of the nasal bridge. It is available in neonatal sizes, infant size, child size, and adult sizes. And different methods, different forms are also available, the one curved one and the one straight ones. And which has a benefit of slowing down the oxygen, and the other benefit is improved anatomical fit. If you have your nasal septum is thick, then you can use a wider ones. So it has a different sizes and models are available. And whenever it can deliver up to, we use up to 4 liters in through nasal cannulas. When you don't have an high flow and you want to use this nasal cannula more than 4 liters, then better to heat and humidify and then deliver. And more than when you use more than 6 liters, it generally causes nasal irritation and dryness of your nasal mucosa. So the recommended flow rates through this nasal cannula in case of neonates, 0.5 to 1 liter per minute you can use. In case of infants, 1 to 2 liters per minute. And in case of children, 1 to 4 liters per minute. And usually try to avoid using more than 4 liter per minute, because it, as I said, it can cause your dryness of nasal mucosa. And if you want to use more than 4 liters, better to use with a humidifier. So the FiO2 that is delivered is 25% to 36% through this nasal cannula. So advantages of this is it is easy to fix, simple, it is lightweight, it is less cost. And with this nasal prongs, you can feed the baby also, and is better tolerated by the children rather than the face mask, which disturbs the children. And it is a sort of disadvantages, as I said, it is uncomfortable for the children. And it can cause nasal trauma and mucosal irritation, and drying can cause, epistaxis can occur, and even ear tenderness can cause. So this is a humidifier that we use when you use more than 4 liters, and this to prevent this dryness of secretions. You can use either cold water or hot water. Heated water is better, they say, and more than 35 liters of FiO2 you want, or more than 4 liters you use this humidifier. The amount of water to be used depends on the manufacturer they advise. The level will be set in that, where you fill the water in that. And even according to the manufacturer's instruction, the water in the bottle has to be changed, frequency they mention. Coming to this nasal catheters and nasopharyngeal catheters, we don't use these nowadays because we have other devices which are better than this and which are advantages than this. In case of settings where you don't have any other devices to deliver, then you can use these nasal catheters. This is a single lumen catheter that is placed in the anterior nase, and the recommended flow rate is 0.5 to 2 liters per minute, and the FiO2 delivered is 35% to 45%. And if you suspect there's a nasal block is there, or the mucosal loss of secretions are there, as a mucosal tear is there, better to avoid these nasal catheters. And it doesn't have any advantage over your, other than your less cost, it doesn't, and availability doesn't have any advantage of over your nasal cannulas. This frequent blockage of these catheters can occur, and if it gets displaced into the esophagus, it can cause distension of the stomach, and gag reflex can occur. So how much to insert is, this is how you, the distance should be from the nostril to the lower inner canthus of the eye should be measured, and it should not be visible below the uvula. This is how it is placed and it's fixed. So these are nasal catheters. This is nasopharyngeal catheter, which goes a little bit deeper than the nasal catheter. I said these are nasopharyngeal catheters, which go deep inside the pharynx, and it slightly delivers a higher flows, like not a higher flows, it gives a better higher peep than because it passes through your, nasopharynx, and your catheter size can be used, bigger size, 8 French to 14 French can be used. While using this, better to use a lubricant. And the recommended oxygen is flow rates uses 0.5 to 2 liters per minute. And the FiO2 delivered is slightly higher than the nasal catheters. So disadvantage of this is it can, as I said, nasal catheters, this also can get blocked with your mucus. And when it is inserted deeper, it can cause your gagging. And if it is displaced into the esophagus, it can cause abdominal distension, and aspiration can occur. And because it passes through your nasopharynx, your natural humidification system is hampered. So better to use with a humidifier when you use your nasopharyngeal catheters. And the other disadvantage is it can cause mucosal irritation and pain in the sinuses. It can cause, because it's a high flow, and it's a high flow device without your humidification. So this is the length that is to be inserted is, this is how it is measured. It is 1 centimeter less than the distance from the side of the nostril to the front of the tragus of the ear, and the tip should be visible just below the uvula. Coming to the next device, that is a simple face mask, also called as Hudson mask. It is a transparent mask with two side holes, which are called the exhalation ports. The flow rate that is recommended is 5 to 8 liters per minute, and a minimum of 5 liters should be used to prevent your carbon dioxide rebreathing. And if it is an infant or if it is a neonate, then you can use a flow rate of 4 liters per minute. And generally, a flow rate more than 8 liters is not recommended, because there is no advantage of using more than 8 liters of flow rate. And this is also a variable performance device, as it provides FiO2 of 40 to 60%. So the advantage of this is when you have a nasal block, or when your nasal passages of when fully blocked, or they have a when you have a nasal block, you can use this face mask. And the disadvantage is, in case of children, they feel uncomfortable with this face mask, and it can interfere with your speaking, and feeding the child also is difficult. And this has to be properly fit to prevent your rebreathing of CO2. So proper fit size and mask has to be used when you use this simple face mask. Your next device is your partial rebreather mask. This is different from your non-rebreather mask. So partial rebreather mask is a mask, basically a face mask with your reservoir bag. And because the advantage of this is, the oxygen flows directly into the reservoir bag, and this, and when you inspire, you inspire the gas oxygen from the reservoir bag. So your FiO2 will be more than your whatever is provided. And the valves that are present are there are three valves. That's two exhalation valves and one valve in between the mask and the reservoir bag. And this is a two-way valve where you inspire air and you expire also through the when your expired gas usually goes out through those two upper exhalation ports, and some can go into your reservoir bag also. So if your oxygen supply is cut suddenly, your reservoir bag has an oxygen, so you can inspire oxygen through that reservoir bag. So this has an advantage of over your NRM, whereas an NRM has a one-way valve. When your oxygen supply is cut, you cannot inspire oxygen from the reservoir bag. You can inspire, but compared to other devices, this has an advantage. So it delivers an FiO2 of 60 to 80%, and the minimum flow rate that is required is 8 liters per minute. And a flow rate less than that can cause CO2 rebreathing. And always monitor that your reservoir bag should be at least 1/3 to half of it should be filled. So as I said, advantage of this is useful in situations where you have scarcity of oxygen. This reservoir bags can deliver more FiO2 compared to your other low flow devices. And disadvantage is more oxygen is required to inflate the bags. More flow rates are required compared to your nasal prongs and nasal masks. And it even interferes with the eating and drinking and talking to the children. So next is a non-rebreather mask. This has three masks, similar to your rebreather mask. The difference is this is a one-way valve here. They have two expiratory valves, which allows your CO2 to wash out, and one inspiratory valve. The flow rates, the advantage of this is it provides a higher FiO2, up to 80 to 90% it provides, and the flow rate recommended is at least 10 to 15 liters to inflate the bag. So advantage is high possible FiO2 when you don't have an high flow nasal cannulas, and you can just have a bridge for intubation, and it is used in spontaneously breathing patients. Disadvantage is the proper NRM mask, which good quality ones are all 375 to 400 rupees. It's available even for 175 rupees, but the proper ones are 375 rupees, and it's slightly expensive. And it requires a tight seal and to prevent your CO2 retention. So basically, patient feels uncomfortable when the mask is tight, and it interferes with your eating and drinking, and it is not suitable for long term use. So this is the difference between your partial rebreather mask and non-rebreather mask, where you have a one-way valve in the in case of an NRM, and it is a two-way valve in case of partial tibial mask. Coming to the next device, which is your Venturi mask. This is a variable performance device. It is designed to deliver a specific percentage of FiO2. Like if you want to, already you are on 35%, and if you want to deliver a 40% of FiO2, and you want to monitor the PF ratios, and you want higher flow also, when you on your low flow, when you use a low flow and it's not able to deliver, when you want to use a high flow devices, then you use a Venturi mask. So there are different color mask, different color this Venturi is available, which requires a particular flow rate to deliver the particular FiO2. Like this, if you see the red color Venturi mask, it uses a 10 liters of flow rate to deliver 40% of FiO2. So these are called fixed performance devices and variable performance, because they even deliver low flow and high flow also. So it works on the Bernoulli's principle. Your next high flow is your oxygen hood or a head box, we say. It is usually used in infants or children's less than 10 kgs. The flow rate required is 8 to 10 liters per minute to prevent your CO2 accumulation in the head box. And the FiO2 that you can deliver with this device is 85 to 95%. The disadvantage of this is it cannot be used in bigger children, and it uses high oxygen because your flow rates are high. It uses up to 10 liters, and 10 liters of flow rates of oxygen is required. So in a nutshell, these are the delivery devices which are available. First, the nasal prongs. The oxygen flow rate required is 1 to 4 liters per minute. And the FiO2 delivered is 25 to 35%, and it can be used in mild hypoxia in case of respiratory distress. And then there comes your face mask, slightly higher FiO2 delivers, and the oxygen flow rate required is 4 to 6 liters per minute. Then your Venturi, then comes your Venturi mask. In between, we can Venturi mask, which is a variable performance device, and it's a fixed performance device also, where it delivers up to 60% of FiO2, and the flow rate required is 3 to 15 liters per minute. The minimum you can deliver with this is your 24% of oxygen, and maximum 60% of oxygen. Then comes your partial rebreather and non-rebreather mask, where flow rates of 8 to 15 liters is required, and the FiO2 that is delivered is 60 to 90%. And this is used in case of severe hypoxemia. So once you use these low flow devices, and if your child is in respiratory distress and the child is worsening, do we directly go to CPAP? So we'll just see a video on what all the devices just I spoke.
Greetings from Pediatric Intensive Care Unit at Christian Medical College, Vellore. In this short video, we are going to talk about the oxygen delivery system. Here we have my colleague, Dr. Sankit, consultant, and Mrs. Rekha, a respiratory therapist. As you know, oxygen delivery systems depends on the purpose, performance, and the patient. That means the degree of hypoxemia, the requirement of precision with which the oxygen has to be delivered, patient comfort, and the cost as well. So Dr. Sankit, could you please tell us about the oxygen delivery systems?
Oxygen delivery systems can be divided broadly into two categories: low flow oxygen devices and high flow oxygen devices. One more classification is variable performance devices and fixed performance devices. Low flow systems, we have this nasal cannula, nasal catheters, Hudson mask or face mask. In high flow or variable performance devices, we have Venturi mask, partial non-rebreather mask, non-rebreather mask, and head box.
All right, thank you. So we'll go one by one. And what about this?
So this is a nasal prongs. It's a low flow device. So we'll show how to connect this one. A flow liters of 0.5 up to 4 liters per minute can be used. When you use more than 4 liters per minute, or FiO2 requirement is more than 35%, you can use a humidifier. The advantage of this is it's comfortable for the patient, and the patient can take only when it is put.
So, thank you. Next.
Next is a simple face mask or Hudson mask, we say. A flow of more than
4 liters or 6 liters per minute, and maximum of 8 liters per minute can be used. And it delivers an FiO2 of 40% to 60%. And it requires a humidifier to be connected because it's more than 35% of oxygen. Disadvantage of this is it covers both the nose and the mouth and slight discomfort for the patient.
Okay, so this we connect from 5 to 8 liters per minute.
Okay.
Thank you. Next.
Next is we have this nasal catheters. We use it less nowadays. It can be used up to 0.5 to maximum 2 liters per minute. The length that has to be inserted is from your ala nasa up to the lower eyebrow.
So how much oxygen we can collect?
It can collect up to 2 liters per minute. And it delivers up to 40% of the FiO2, maximum 30% of the
FiO2. Alright, next.
Next we have a Venturi mask, which is a variable performance device. So they are different color coded. It is used when a specific oxygen concentration has to be delivered. So depending upon the FiO2 you are required, like it's this 35%, 8 liters has to be kept in the flow rate. So they will show how to connect this one.
So this is yellow, so we have to connect 8 liters per minute.
And it delivers up to 35% of fixed 35% of FiO2. So it has to fix tightly and patient has to be split spontaneously.
So I connected 8 liters per minute of oxygen.
So it has both low flow and high flow. When your oxygen flow rate goes up, it becomes a high flow, and with low flow rates, it is a low flow device.
So how much is the lowest we can connect?
It's 21% also we have. That is the white color we have.
So it is mentioned the percentage of FiO2 when the oxygen is delivered at a particular minute. Thank you. We'll go to the next.
Next we have this non-rebreather mask with a flow rate of up to 6 to 8 liters per minute has to be kept, and it comes in a high flow device. Disadvantage of this is there are no valves in this, and there is a mixing of your expired CO2 also. So the maximum,
this is a partial rebreather mask, and there are no valves
in this.
But the advantage is it has a reservoir
and FiO2 of up to 60% can be given.
When there is a limited supply of oxygen we can use, rather than your non-rebreathing mask, where we have to have a full filling of the reservoir. Here we can have up to half to 1/3. Probably 8 liters.
8 liters per minute.
So it has to fill at least half of it. And it has to be tightly fit.
So this is the non-rebreather mask, which has two expiratory valves, and here we have an inspiratory valve, it's a one-way valve, and there is no rebreathing of your carbon dioxide, it's in here. So they will show how to fix this one. So your bag has to be filled, the flow rate that has to be kept is at least 10 liters per minute should be kept. The bag should be, reservoir bag should be full, and the mask should tightly fit. And FiO2 up to 95% can be delivered to this non-rebreather mask, and it comes under a high flow device. The patient breathes, this ball moves up and down, and your bag should be full, and the mask should be tight.
So how much FiO2 will be delivered?
85% to 90% of FiO2 can be delivered with this.
So the bag has to be full, and it should be tightly fit. So minimum 10 to 15 liters. Thank you. Next.
We have this head box. It's also a high flow device. It can be used in fans, and the weight of least less than 10 kg we can use. So flow rate of at least 10 liters should be kept, and FiO2 delivered is around 90%, up to 95% of what it delivers. Flow rate is kept at 10 liters so that your flow occurs and there is no CO2 retention.
Thank you. With this, we complete the oxygen delivery system. Thank you.
So that was the video on the low flow devices and some common high flow devices we use. So if the child is deteriorating further on these devices, do we directly go to your CPAP or your non-invasive ventilation, or do we have any other device? Because these CPAPs, if you can see these photos which shows patient and patient has these injuries because of this CPAP and the other complications like gaseous distension can occur, and your nursing care has to be more when you go for your non-invasive or invasive ventilation. So there's something called high flow HFNC, your heated humidified high flow nasal cannula, which you can consider before going for your non-invasive or your invasive ventilation. So what is this HFNC? This is an device which provides a higher flow of oxygen and higher effort of oxygen. And in other words, we say the more than your patient's inspiratory demand is which it provides, and it heats and it humidifies the oxygen and then sends in, which prevents all your complications of oxygen that is provided through the slow flow devices. So this device has an oxygen blender where it consumes oxygen from the atmosphere and it blends oxygen with it, and it heats and humidifies oxygen and then delivers through a single lumen through the patient nasal cannula. And it doesn't require your invasive, non-invasive, your interfaces which covers your face or your mouth. Through a nasal cannula, it can deliver high flows. So initially in early 2000s, you have this VAPO term, which developed your 2000i, which is a device with a high flow device through the principle of heated cartridge type using the membrane technology. But because of some few complications like your bacterial contamination and other complications, this was called off. And then in later 2006, this Fisher and Plakel, they formed this OptiFlow, which become commercially available. And they use a different system that overcomes all this VapoTherm's complications. And this humidifier is similar to the one which we use in your ventilators, your non-invasive ventilation in invasive ventilations, where they use this plate system of plate and chamber system of humidifier. And it can, with the low cost, and it can deliver high flow humidified oxygens. This is the first device, which is called your OptiFlow. And then came this with further changes. And this is called AirVO2, where you can adjust all your temperature, your flow, and your FiO2 in three different manners. We can modify each thing separately, whichever depends on the patient and depending on the requirement of the oxygen, we can change it. So what is the mechanism of action of this device? So as I said, there's a mnemonic called high flow, where H stands for heated and humidified. Your air that it delivers is heated and humidified and delivered. And the flow that is delivered is more than the patient's inspiratory demand. That stands for I. And it fulfills your FRC. And it replaces your FRC also, and your nasal pharyngeals and your anatomical airway and all can be replaced with your oxygen. And the device is lighter. It is very lighter to carry, and it can be used in transport also. And your oxygen dilution occurs. All your nasopharynx and all is replaced by your oxygen with the help of this device. And oxygen dilution also can be done. Like your flow, only if you can deliver just flow if you required, and this flow can be mixed with oxygen and scent. And all your death space is washed out, and it's replaced by your oxygen. So what are the indications of this? The common indications we use is in case of severe pneumonia, we can use rather than using a non-invasive ventilation. In case of bronchiolitis, in case of acute severe asthma, we can use. This device also can be used as a weaning modality. When you extubate a patient, rather than using your non-invasive, in some places, some patients like newborns, these devices can replace your CPAP machines. And it can be used also in your transport of a critically ill child. And the indications for in neonates is respiratory distress syndrome or an apnea of prematurity. The flow that these devices deliver can cause a stimulation of this patients and can prevent apnea. And in case of congenital cardiac diseases, you can use, and as I said, in case of weaning from your extubation, post extubation also you can use. Studies have shown that this doesn't improve mortality, but it can prevent, it has shown to improve your oxygenation, and it can be used, it can prevent ventilation also. And in case of COVID situations, your WHO and your Society of Critical Care Medicines have also shown, and they have also recommended to use high flow before considering intubation in case of initial management of your COVID-19 pneumonia. In case of ARDS, you should consider HFNC is what they say. This is the algorithm from the SCCM guidelines, where if you see before intubation, they are telling us to consider HFNC rather than directly intubating the patients, and it has shown advantages and improvement also. So what are the contraindications? Absolute contraindications are there's a trauma to the nasopharynx, or there's a surgery done to your nasopharynx because these high flow devices can damage your nasal pharyngeal mucosa. It is better to avoid, and in case of base of skull fracture, better to avoid this high flow devices. The other relative contraindications are when child is not breathing, then no use in giving your when child is respiratory failure, we directly better to go up with intubation. When there is a coronal atresia or facial anomalies or injuries to your nasal septum is already there, then better not to use this one. And in those cases, better to use your nasal mask and NRM. When there is an excessive secretions or nose block is there, there's no use in using this high flow that does not pass oxygen through the secretions. And there is a bowel obstruction. These are all bowel obstructions are relative contraindication, not a contraindication. You can use a NG tube to decompress the stomach, and then you can use. And when there is a pneumothorax or a pneumomediastinum, you can come down on your flows, and you can use a higher FiO2. Or in case of newborns, better to avoid when there is a pneumothorax these high flow devices. And if you're when there is a poor GCS and your patient doesn't like this, then better not to use this device. So coming to the basic setup of this equipment, we'll come to a video also. We'll just tell you about this equipment. There's a blender and a blender and a flow meter which consumes oxygen from the atmospheric air, and it blends oxygen from the flow meter, and it heats and humidifies from the humidifier, and through this single inspiratory circuit which has a metal tubing tubings inside the circuit which maintains the temperature throughout the delivery, and through the nasal cannula it delivers its high flow devices. So setting up the equipment, as I said, initially install the water inside the chamber, and that water is connected to a distilled water or sterile water, and then your this machine is connected to a power supply from where your heating occurs for the humidifier. Once it is connected, then you connect your circuit, and then your nasal cannula is connected. Then your settings, whatever desired settings is there, you set up a temperature of 37 degrees, 37 in case of adult children and 34 in case of pediatrics, and the desired flow and the desired FiO2 we can connect. For this FiO2, you have to connect the machine to your oxygen source. If you don't require an oxygen or you just require a flow that is required in case of apnea children, then you can just connect to the machine to the power flow, power supply, and then you can use this machine. So these are the different nasal cannulas in case of children, in case of adults, and in case of tracheostomy patients also you can use. If the patient is uncomfortable with the nasal cannula, then you can use a mask interface also. So the appropriate size of the nasal cannula should be used. It should be approximately 50% of the inner diameter of the nose, and to exhale your CO2 and prevent your CO2 retention. So at least it should be 50%. It should not be a tightly fitting nasal cannula. And the distance between the prongs should be at least, depending upon the thickness of your septum, adequate distance should be there in your nasal cannula that you select. It should not be tightly fitting, and it should not cause ischemia of your nasal septums. So depending upon the manufacturers, there are different color-coded nasal interfaces available. You see, this is XS is extremely small size, medium size, large size, and your extremely large sizes. Depending upon the weight and depending upon the age, there are different nasal septums available, and this varies according to the manufacturers. This is from the Fisher and Paykel company. I have taken this wide ranges of nasal interfaces that is available. So how do we set? So the initial control variables I said is the temperature, your FiO2, and your flow. How much temperature set is in case of adults and elder children? You can use up to 37 degrees Celsius. In case of pediatrics, we usually use 34 degrees Celsius. And depending on the flow also, your temperature varies. when you use a high flow, you use a higher temperatures also. So the FiO2, as I said, depending upon the clinical situation and your desired PaO2s and desired FiO2, your FiO2 can vary from 21% to 100%. And depending upon the PaO2, you can titrate the oxygen, and depending upon the oxygen available, you can titrate your oxygen FiO2 through this. And flow rates, as I said, there are no consensus guidelines on how much flow rate to set. But the formula which we use is this 2 liters per kg for the first 10 kgs, and for the next 10 for the and more than 10 kgs, you use 0.5 liters per minute. And the maximum you can use is in case of children, in case of infants, we use up to maximum of 10 liters. And in case of children from depending upon the weight, this is the tabular column which shows the maximum flow rate you can use. In adults, we go up to 60 liters per minute also. So for example, if it is a child with the 10 kgs, sorry, we'll take a child with a weight of 15 kgs. So for the first 10 kg, we use 2 liters per kg. So that will be 20 liters. And for the next 5 liters, it will be 0.5 liters. That will be 2.5 liters. So 22.5 liters. So approximately 25 liters flow you can set. And depending upon your FiO2 and depending upon your PaO2 and your saturation, you can increase your FiO2. And how do you know if it is child has responded or not? You monitor the heart rate, respiratory rate, you work out breathing, then you do an ABGNC and do a chest X-ray. And if child is still after monitoring all this, if your saturation is not improving, it is still less than 92%, there's no improvement in your tachycardia or tachypnea has not come down, your respiratory effort has also not come down, then you can try to go up on the flow rates, 0.5 liters per kg per minute you can go. And according to the tabular column, as I showed, you can go up to the maximum flow rates. On that also, if the child doesn't improve, then better to go on your, you can escalate your delivery devices. Like you can go with your non-invasive ventilation, or you go ahead with your intubation. So what are the complications of this HFNC? They are usually relatively safe compared to other devices, but the complication they can cause are your abdominal distension can cause. That can be avoided by placing a NG tube and decompress the stomach. And in case of neonates, in case of small babies, that can cause air leaks and it can cause pneumothorax because of these high flows. The studies have shown that these high flows can deliver a PEEP up to 3 millimeter of mercury also, so 3 millimeter of water also. So sometimes in case of newborns or in case of preterm babies, they can cause air leaks. And the other side effects are this, because of this high flow, it can cause dryness also in case of trauma to your nasal mucosa with those nasal interfaces we use. And a lot of them have a frequent question, can we, child is on high flow or optic flow, can we feed the child? Yes, you can feed the child. You can place a nasopharyngeal tube. You can at least, when the child is on low flows, like 10 liters per minute or 12 liters per minute, you can give directly orally also. Or when they are in the high flow, better to place an NG tube and then start orogastric feeds or nasogastric feeds can be started. And every fourth hourly, you can decompress stomach to just to remove the air from the stomach, just to prevent discomfort. And basically when we start feeding, we don't always go up on the full feeds, but we just go up to 80% of the total requirement of the feed, just to prevent aspiration. Otherwise, there is no contraindication to feed the child when a child is on your high flow nasal cannulas. Just few slides on this AMBU bag. This AMBU bag is a self-inflating bag. This is a self-inflating bag, so you don't require any flow to inflate the bag. You just compress the bag, and your air is delivered. And there's a peep valve where too much of air also can't be delivered. Well, you should. And when you are required to increase your FiO2, then your oxygen source can be connected, and the reservoir bag can be connected behind the bag to improve your FiO2. So these are called self-inflating, because when you compress the bag, it delivers the pressure required and air oxygen required, and it inflates, self-inflates, and fills up in the bag. So these are all called self-inflating bags. The advantage of this is it can be used in transport. It doesn't require, when your oxygen cylinders are emptied, you don't have we don't have an oxygen cylinder, or in case of settings where you can't use oxygen, then you can use these AMBU bags. So when you deliver this, there should be a tight seal. This is the EC clamp technique. You should use a tight seal. Then only you can deliver the, your desired oxygen. And so with the flow, the effort that delivered through this is 30 to 50% without your reservoir bag, and 80 to 100% when you use the reservoir bag. And usually gives a, then this can be used as a positive pressure rather than using your as your as your oxygen devices. So the next device which you can use for positive pressure is just flow inflating bags. This is also called as your modified Jackson-Rees circuit. It is a type E of your Jackson-Rees circuit. The disadvantage of this is you require a flow, either a high, you require a air or you require oxygen to inflate this bag. And the advantage of this is you can deliver the you can deliver higher pressure more than your AMBU bag. Your AMBU bag has a PEEP valve where it can't deliver more pressure, more PEEP can't be delivered. And this flow inflating bag you can use to deliver a higher PEEP. And this also can be used in transportation, and it can be used in a bridge for intubation where you can, where you have a modified rapid sequence intubation, there you want to increase your FRC and deliver more FiO2 during the intubation, you can use these flow inflating bags. So when you select, when you deliver an oxygen, your purpose, your the three main piece you should remember is purpose of the oxygen, purpose of why we are using this device, whether it is just a respiratory distress or it is a respiratory failure. And the patient, which patient we are going to use, if it is a new, is it a newborn or is it an infant or is it a elder children, because it, with the, and the performance of the device, low, when in child is in respiratory distress or severe respiratory distress, you can't use a low flow device. So this three piece you should consider when whenever you're going to start oxygen, consider these three piece. Why you're starting oxygen, which patient you're going to start, and this will be your, will this device satisfy your purpose of giving your oxygen. So your purpose, as I said, so you should check whether will this device improve your arterial hypoxia, will be satisfied with this device. And the other patient factors like severity of hypoxia, patient age group, as I said, in case of infants and newborns, you can use hot oxygen hood to deliver high flow devices. And in case of adult, like bigger children, we can't use your nasal hood. And the degree of consciousness also, when a child is when child is in low sensorium, you can't use your high flow nasal cannulas. So this is a, so all these three pieces you should consider before selecting a device. And once you selected a device, your device should also, you should use the device properly also. When you use it should be applied properly, proper micropore should be used, and properly it should be secured properly when you deliver. Like if your NRM is not fixed properly, it can cause CO2 rebreathing, CO2 retention can occur. And then when you don't fix your nasal cannulas properly, that can cause damage to your nasal mucosal, nasal septum can occur. So when you use a face mask, ensure that always it covers the mouth and the nose and not the eyes, because your eyes can get damaged when you use when you use a bigger size mask, face mask. And you should always use a proper adhesives to secure the nasal cannula or an elastic strap in case of face mask. Face mask comes with the elastic strap that should be tight. And the distance between the two prongs also should be adequate. It should not be tightly fitting, and so that your ischemia of your nasal septum can occur. And when you ensure always that the infant's head remains inside the oxygen hood. And if your child is not comfortable, but if one method of the oxygen delivery upsets the child, please consider changing to another method. So what do you monitor? So when you start this oxygen, always monitor your adverse effects also, and decide your outcome you should measure. So better to monitor the positive effects and monitor that negative effects also. So just see whether your child has improved or not, whether if the oxygenation is improved or not. As I said, daughter, the as in initial I showed one slide where you can, the oxygenation parameters you can monitor, SpO2, PaO2, your oxygenation index, your PF ratio and SF ratio you can monitor. And you should even see the child, whether the respiratory distress has come down or not, your heart rate and tachycardia, tachypnea has come down or not, your blood pressures are improved or not, and child sensorium has improved. And the other, you should monitor for the other side effects of the oxygen, not only your oxygenation, but the other side effects of the devices also you should monitor. Local side effects you should monitor, like skin breakdown and damage to the nasal septum also you should monitor. So as I said, your heart rate should come down by at least by 20%. Your respiratory rate should have come down. Your breathing pattern, your work of breathing should have improved. Your blood pressure should have improved. Saturations should have improved. And if your saturation doesn't improve and if none of this occurs, consider your oxygen therapy. And then oxygen flow rates, keep monitoring the oxygen flow rates. You should not waste oxygen also. If your FiO2 is reached 100% and your distress has come down, always try to come down on your oxygen FiO2. And that can be monitored with the help of your blood gases, your chest x-rays you do. And frequently monitor for the side effects of the device. You can monitor your nasal septums and nasal mucosas. And keep monitoring your tubing. Sometimes leak can occur. And you keep going on your FiO2 and there would have been a leak in the tubings and your mask would have been not fixed properly or your condensation would have been disturbing your delivering of oxygen. So we'll see a small video on this high flow devices, both OptiFlow and Airvo. We'll see first on OptiFlow.
This is high-flow nasal cannula therapy using OptiFlow, which has a heated humidifier. On top, we have the water chamber with a pop-pop valve for the safety mechanism. And we have the breathing circuit connected to the patient using the interface appropriate for the age. Here, for the pediatric age, we have used the green interface. We have connected to the oxygen and airflow meter through the tube. It's connected to the oxygen and air. And they are mixed by a Y connector. And we can adjust the air and oxygen flow so that we can get an approximate FiO2 based on a chart. So this is how to use air oxygen mixture without a proper blender. We don't have a blender here. In that, we can use air and oxygen mixture using a white connector, but that will be an approximate FiO2 can be given. Right? Heated humidified high flow nasal cannula therapy, HSFNC. And this is the air motor machine, setting up of the machine. These are the accessories which is necessary for the equipment I would do. We have the water chamber with an adapter, which should be fitted before starting the equipment. We have a sterile water for irrigation, for the humidification. And we have the heated breathing circuit to be connected to the machine and to the patient. Then we have an important thing, it's called the interface of different color coded, starting from red, yellow, purple, and we have the green, which is the pediatric. This is all color coded for the respective age group. And this is for an young adult. And now I request Rekha, a respiratory therapist, to assemble the air motor machine. For this patient, who is about 20 kilos, who has got some respiratory distress with saturating around 86%. This is the water heater, ring filter. It's to supply water for irrigation. And the breathing circuit. And I selected this interface, the green one, for the pediatric age group. So now we are ready to go and connect to the patient. Before that, we have to set the flow. So as I said, it's approximately 20 kilos. And we have selected 25 liters of flow. And I would like a FiO2 of around 40%. So we are connecting 25 liters of flow, we have failed to 40%. Are you connected? Let's get it on. So it's adjusting the flow to 25 liters and locking it. And you connect oxygen to the flow meter, wall flow meter, and adjust accordingly to get a 40% FiO2. I'm getting a good flow here. So shall we connect, please? So we are connecting and making sure it's not snugly fitting. We need to have at least 50% of space for the expired air to come out. So now this child, weighing about 20 kilos, is being given a 25 liters of flow with an air mode, FiO2 of 40%. And the saturation and viscosity getting better. After using of every patient, you can use this tube to disinfect the equipment.
Okay, so that was a video on how to set up your HFNC, both OptiFlow and Airvo. So next I'll be talking few slides on the strategies to reduce your oxygen consumption in your COVID era when there's a scarcity for oxygen. I'll just talk about the ICU acute care strategies that you can use to reduce your oxygen consumption. So coming to the first one, you can use a oxygen conservative goals, like you can you can reduce your targets, like in children you can accept up to 94% of your saturation and a PaO2 of 55 to 70%, and you can reduce your FiO2 if this child is saturating at 94%. And but in case of situations where it has to be used, you can use, but where you can avoid, you should come down on FiO2 with setting your low targets. So next strategy is you can put the patient in prone position, because studies have shown prone position improves your oxygenation and improves your VQ mismatch. With the child now, you can put the child in prone position and then you can oxygenate. And when child breathes or your patient breathes, your oxygen demand increases. Like a child is on invasive ventilation or even your non-invasive ventilation, when they breathe on, when they fight with, or when they are agitated or they are hyperventilate on your ventilation, that can consume more oxygen. So better to use sedations or paralysis when the child is used, when the child is given non-invasive or invasive ventilations. And always try to avoid using 100% of oxygen to treat your pneumothorax or pneumomediastinum. You can reduce your flow. You can downgrade from your non-invasive to non-invasive to your high flow oxygens, and you can reduce your FiO2 and you can use with low targets of PaO2. And other strategies, as I said, not only your oxygen increase your tissue oxygenation, you can increase your cardiac output, you can maintain your hemoglobin, normal hemoglobin, and FRCs you can improve, so that you can improve your oxygenation, not only your FiO2. And avoid this oxygen consuming devices, like there's devices which consume more oxygen, your balloon, there's something called balloon CPAPs which consume more oxygens. And better to use your positive pressure ventilation like CPAP and BiPAP or non-invasive ventilation, which provides more pressure and less FiO2. And when the child doesn't require, when child is not in acute severe asthma, when just child requires nebulization, you can use your MDIs rather than using your oxygen flow meters to deliver this nebulizations. And whenever you're using a nasal cannula, you can use a mask over your nasal cannula that can act as a reservoir. And it has an advantages of preventing spreading of infection also. And when your child is on a ventilator, you can use nebulizations through your ultrasonic, which doesn't use flow meters to deliver the oxygen. And there are other innovative devices also which uses less oxygen and delivers high flows. And when you use your non-invasive ventilation like a BiPAP machine or CPAP machines, so this is the tabular column which shows when you use your high pressures and you use a, for example, when you use a high pressure of 18 by 10 and you use your six liters of flow, if you see, you can see this with low pressures, the 6 liters of flow delivers a higher FiO2. And when you use a high pressures, the 6 liters of flow delivers only 30% of FiO2. So as soon as the patient improves, better to come down your pressures on the non-invasive ventilation, because low pressures, your delivery of oxygen also is low with low flow rates. And always when you use your mask, better to use a tight fitting mask that can prevent oxygen leak. And your NIV mask that can leak compensation occurs, it consumes more oxygen. So better to use a proper fitting mask. And when you use NIV, better to use proper sedation and avoid hyperventilation of the patient and use low pressures. So when you use NIV, use proper sedation, use low pressures and use a tight fitting mask when you use non-invasive like BiPAP or CPAP patients. And you can use, rather than using your Venturi mask, better to use a non-rebreather mask that can be partial or it can be NRM, because these NRM bags have an advantage of when patient expires, the incoming oxygen can be used to fill the bag and you can inspire those oxygen during inspiration. And your NRM partial rebreather uses a low flow rates, like 6 to 8 liters per minute compared to your NRM. And it can deliver more FiO2 compared to your Venturi flow devices. Like a 6 liter to 8 liter flow of Venturi device can deliver up to 40%. Whereas an NRM, it can deliver up to 60% of FiO2 when you use 8 liters of flow. The other system level strategies, like you can have a oxygen round daily separate, like we used to have to prevent your hospital acquired infections. We have bundles we can use for like oxygen rounds or oxygen audit. You can check the leak or frequently in every shift. You should think whether this child requires oxygen, or if it requires, this child requires so much of FiO2 or this much of flow, is it required or not. So this, and you can set up alarm limits on this saturations, where if your child saturation goes down below 94%, then you can go up on your FiO2. And like when you give a suction, we use oxygen breaths. We forget to come down on your FiO2 after suctioning. Your flow meters, you should check on every shift whether there's any leak, or your calibration of flow meters should be checked frequently. And in case of intubated patients, when you use high pressures, or when you use your ventilation, again, if you use high pressure, that can cause damage to the lungs, and that can cause ventilation induced lung injury. So that again, your patient mortality and morbidity goes up, and your oxygen consumption also goes up. So better to use your ventilation strategies that can prevent lung injuries, like low tidal volume. You can use driving pressures of less than 15 centimeter of water, and low PEEP you can use. And monitor the tube cuff and cuff pressures and leaks to prevent oxygen leaks and to prevent using of high pressures. The other strategies, like you can use liquid oxygen cylinders that stores large amount of oxygen in case of in a small instrument. And if you don't have a sterile water, you can use distilled water to humidify your high flows. And a frequent check on your anesthesia machines should be used, because these anesthesia machines, you can have frequent slow leak of oxygen, and oxygen consumption can occur. And when you have two patients with same flow, you can use a Y connector with a single device, and you can deliver the same FiO2. And when you use a face mask, or as I said, high flow, you can use a surgical mask above that can act as a reservoir. And there are, if you have oxygen concentrators available, then you can use your oxygen concentrators to deliver the oxygen rather than using the flow meters and oxygen cylinders to deliver. So this is a oxymizer. This is a new device which conserves oxygen. This device, if you see in that image, there is a nasal cannula, which has a balloon on it and a pendant. There are different moustache type and your cannula type, where it stores oxygen and it delivers higher oxygen in during your next breath. This is similar to your reservoir bag. This cannulas can be used both in your HFNC machines and or your non-invasive ventilation you can use. You can, in case of hospitals, you can run an oxygen stewardship program where you can have oxygen audit and frequent check on the oxygen flow meters, frequent calibrations, and cuff tube, cuff pressures, your pressure gauges can be monitored frequently. And you can have a mock drill, like we have for fire drill, like if there is a sudden fire, we have a fire drills we can use, like suddenly if there is an oxygen cutoff supply, what will you do? So we can conduct mock drills in the hospitals. And when there's going to be a scarcity of oxygen, better to send a message to all the doctors and staff nurses that there's a scarcity, and this, that's how much time your oxygen supply will last, so that they will be prepared for an alternative source. So coming to the final slide, your take home message is oxygen is a precious source and a precious drug, and it should be used judiciously and efficiently. And you should have a knowledge on what are the data, and right device should be used on the right patient at the right time. And it, and your frequent monitoring of your oxygen therapy and should be done to frequent to early de-escalation of your oxygen therapy. Thank you.
Over to the moderators, Dr. Ankit Gupta and Dr. Antarbhai Patel.
Excellent presentation by Dr. Sanket. I think this was one of the most detailed and exhaustive PPTs. I forgot the number of slides that he had. I think it must be more than 70-80 that I have seen on oxygen therapy. A few questions or few doubts that I would have. Actually, before moderating, I told Sanket, you prepare a list of questions and give it to me, because I was busy, but he didn't prepare. So that's why I have to ask these questions by myself. So ion using a tracheostomy, airvo tracheostomy interface, because we are using, and do you keep the rates same, the 2 liter per kg for the first 10 kg and then 0.5 liters per kg? The tracheostomy interface, because I did not get any reference, we are using here. So over there also, everybody is using, sir, are you using?
Yes, that's what I said. There's no consent guidelines available for this interface. Depending on your, now you will have to adjust depending on your flow rates and your oxygenation also you have to monitor. If child is saturating and your distress is coming down, then you can come down on your flow rates. Otherwise, you have to go up there on the flow rates. And depending on the age, cutoffs, I have told you, 60 liters for adults, I have told you. But there's no cutoff for tracheostomy. There's no cutoffs available.
Yeah, so not the nasal interface, the tracheostomy. Are you using it?
Tracheostomy, that's what I'm saying. There's no guidelines available.
You all are using?
You mean tracheostomy for the high flow nasal cannula?
Yes.
There are available interfaces are there.
I think you need, we haven't used much, Ankit. I was also struggling for the last patient. I think you need a special connector, and I don't think the company gives any recommendations.
The companies, there is an available one nowadays, but we have not used. Ankit, have you come across one? The company is coming out with some device.
Yeah, I have used, sir. I'll send you. So they already have it, but it is, I think, in short supply. So, and they are using it very less. So I have the PDF, I'll send you the picture, so then you can also use it. So it is better, it is good for those people who do not require CPAP, and somewhere between CPAP and while weaning, it is quite useful.
We haven't used it, if you have the, you need an adapter for that, isn't it?
Yeah, that is what Kala, now they have come out, the Fisherman Pike has come out with an adapter. But as he said, it is short supply. They introduced it, but it's not freely available. But they have come out with a new one.
Yeah.
When they introduced the Airvo 2 Plus, they have put it that one.
Yeah. And other guidelines, like the answer to the question, Ankit, maybe you can tell us. the flow rates for high flow through tracheostomy.
I'm using the same for Same fluoride I'm using.
Which we use is based on the Royal Children's Hospital RCH guidelines. That is which is used for all HFNCs. But the principle is you need to use a flow which is more than the inspiratory demand of the patient, right? Mm-hmm. So probably you calculate the minute ventilation and give 3 to 4 times the minute ventilation of the patient. So it's quite a little bit of approximate and see the clinical effects and then adjust.
And see whether there is any hyperinflation of the chest or and how clinical improvement. Accordingly, you can decide your flow rates. Definitely, it will be lesser flow rate required for the customer. Yeah, to answer the Ankit question, see, first thing is there are no guidelines available. Second thing, you know you are reducing 20% of your dead space by tracheostomy. So you cannot track the theoretically 20 to 30% of your flow, see the clinical response, whether if your flow is high, the child will start developing your hyperinflation, come down on flow, go up on it. And depending upon the clinical scenario, take a call on whether this flow is or not. But per se, there are no guidelines for tracheostomized patient, how much flow should be given.
Any comment on the other flow devices? But this he was talking about as Venturi device as a Gessler in critical ill patients. We don't, in children, we don't use MUS, but adults, they do use. That's what is the right. Do you guys use Venturi?
Sir, we have better blender with the Airvo. So I think Venturi is of no use. When we can blend oxygen with our high flow devices, then the Venturi is like outdated.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, they just use during this post extubation meeting, they use. You don't have to open your.
What can I say? Yeah.
Airway is very just for theoretical learning nowadays.
No, Antar is working at a very big setup and is getting all rich patients who are willing to pay. The one tubing of Airvo that night is costing 7,000 and the interface is another, I think, maybe 5,000. So Airvo is a costly thing. If the patient does not pay, then I have to pay. So I am very much particular about cost.
Yes, I think cost is a problem with high flow. The interfaces are expensive. Do you reuse them, Ankit?
Yeah, we ETO them. Somehow we ETO them. We use it for 2-3 times till it breaks. So yeah, we ETO them.
Option is high flow devices. Second cheaper option for high flow is bubble CPAP. You can use as a high flow device, which will be a lot cheaper than your Airvo machine, but it will give you flow up to 50 liters only. So that also can be used as a resource in a resource limited setting.
Okay, bubble CPAP. See, now there are a lot of, I know because I've been involved in that, guys. There are some startups in Bangalore. They have come up with, at least I know two companies, they have come up with like this sort of bubble CPAP plus a HFNC. And with some PEEP adjustment. So their initial charges are like Airvo, but they claim to be the consumables are much cheaper than the Fisher & Paykel. So, you know.